everyone. Yeah, welcome along to this kind of little informal kind of chat panel podcast. Today's kind of theme, we're going to be looking into balancing work, study, and contributing to open source all at the same time, because that's kind of a thing that a lot of us in this call have in common. We've all been in that kind of boat. So before we get right into that, let's do a little round of introductions. So I'll go first. My name's Allison. I'm a co-chair of Kubernetes SIG Contributor Experience. I'm just kind of in between jobs, like, you know, I used to be doing a lot of developer advocacy kind of work over at Weaveworks and working like on Flux project and things like that. And I studied over at the University of Waikato. I did a degree in science. I did a bachelor's in science, majoring in computer science. And with that, I'll hand it over to Matt.
Sure. Hi, I'm Matt. You probably know me from DigitalOcean. I am a community platform manager there, software engineering marketing, just a fancy title because I look after our community stuff. I work mostly on the community site, but also work on all of the marketing properties that we own. So our main www site and things like Hacktoberfest. So I'm lead engineer on that, for example. Outside of work, I also help maintain CDNJS, which is the world's largest open source CDN. So I'm a paid maintainer by Cloudflare for that, and I look after kind of the GitHub side of operations for that.
Cool. Hey, everyone. You all know me because you are on my channel, but still, I'm Kunal. I work as a developer advocate at SIVO. I'm a student right now. I'll be graduating next year. I'm a senior. What else? I started Community Classroom, CNCF students, the student track at KubeCon, which is now official. So very excited about that. If you're a student, you can definitely submit a CFP. But yeah, so many initiatives coming along, and I'm also an MLH coach. I'm a GitHub campus expert, so it's great. And I have my channel. So yeah, that's pretty much about it. And looking forward to, you know, chatting more about how you balance all these things as a student.
I'm just going to say, you both do Kubernetes stuff. I know nothing about Kubernetes, so just keep that in mind.
We got you.
All good, yeah. Actually, one thing is I never really started in Kubernetes, which is kind of the interesting thing. I used to be just like a software dev. I was just writing like C++, Python, Go, like doing test stuff, and like over time just eventually kind of moved into ops. So I think, yeah, we'll try to keep this kind of really kind of focus more on the open source kind of side of things. Let's kind of go into how you all kind of started your journeys. For me, I was just studying. Like, I went to IT school. I went to WinTech, and I remember towards the kind of semi-ish end of the like year, my friend rings me up and he's like, "Come to this guy's garage if you want a job." And I'm like, "That sounds pretty awesome." And so I get there, and then there's just a bunch of computers, and you know, we just got put to work, basically. Yeah.
Nice. I guess I'll so go how much next. Should
yeah
oh go for just have,
go. No, I just had a question, like, how much do you think your college or university or whatever actually helped you in the role that you have like right now? But spoiler alert, for me it did not do much. Like, most of the experiences I have gotten have been outside of college. College is, I'm just doing it for like the mandatory degree, because here in India, like, even though people say that a degree is not mandatory, but trust me, even the biggest tech companies here make it mandatory. But yeah, that's probably why I'm doing a degree, because everything I've learned has been by open source. We'll talk more about that later. But yeah, what about you, Allison? Like, do you think like what you learned in your university and stuff helped you in where you are right now?
I think there were some courses which were like really, really good. But the thing that brings it all together is the degree shows that you can commit to something that's very long, that has very boring parts in it that you might not even be interested in at all. Like, you know, I forgot the name of the class, but there was that pumping lemma formula thing, and I just remember like a block of text, and I just didn't remember stuff. I think the degree helps you kind of, you know, structure your life as well, because of how like you get classes, and it's like you have a class here and then you have a gap of time, then a class. It kind of teaches you how to have a kind of fragmented day. Spoiler alert, I still haven't, you know, I'm still have struggles, like, you know, as a person who's like, you know, now kind of finished uni only at the start of this year, like, I still struggle with these things, but I think university kind of helped that a lot, as well as like kind of collaboration and soft skills. So being in that tertiary environment, you're kind of, I think, and during the pandemic, of course, it's been harder, but when you're on campus, you get to interact and collaborate with other people while they're doing their work. So you get to walk around the computer lab and be like, oh, what you up to? And like, you know, you start building kind of, you know, these connections between your fellow students, and then they come to you and they're like, oh, I'm struggling with X. Like, you know, can you help step through this problem? No plagiarism here. Helping kind of build, like, you know, problem solving skills. I'm going to pass it over to Matt.
Sure. Yeah. So I'm currently still at uni as well, doing a computing degree. I don't know. I'm kind of with you on the actual skills that you get taught in the classes are so disastrously useless that it's not worth being there. But the actual, like, concept of being at uni is useful. It teaches you, I don't know, I feel like it just prepares you for life quite well. That being said, my experience at uni has been completely remote. I started just as COVID hit, and so I was on campus for a single term before they sent us home, and I have now done almost 2 years remote, and I graduate in December, and I won't ever go back to campus again, not even to graduate. So I don't know, I feel like I've had a slightly weird experience because I haven't really ever met most of my peers. But yeah, I don't know. I get what you're saying as well. Like, I'm doing it mostly for the sake of having a degree. Like, I have a job and I'm quite unlikely to need the degree, but there's a societal expectation that I have one and certain companies will expect one from me.
To be quite frank, like with me as well, I'm doing it for the degree, because all the things that I'm learning and everything in communities and open source and stuff, I think that's more than enough for me to get, like, I have a job right now, and with reflecting over the past 3 years of my college degree, I can't seem to find anything that I did not learn outside college, like be that data structures or about DBMS or networking or operating systems or whatever. I learned that like outside college. Even when before COVID, I did not used to attend any classes, because the sole reason being it totally depends on college to college, but my college does not have a really good curriculum, for example, and not really good. I'm trying to see how I can put it softly. The classes are not fun, basically.
Yes.
But the same curriculum when I study it on my own, I love it, right? But when I study it in college, it's sort of like just boring and stuff. So one more reason being, like, my college is 1.5 hours away from my house. So that's like 3 hours of commute. It's a total waste of time. That's the reason, before COVID also, I didn't go. But now that I'm realizing it, like, I didn't really go, and I still ended up being, like, I'm doing fine. My career, I'm now just reflecting, like, what did I do in college? I just gave exams and did self-study on my own.
It's a very expensive piece of paper to say you've got a degree.
I think also there's one thing, like, I think you need the degree as well for relocation. So for me, I'm really lucky to be here in the UK, right? Because I'm a British citizen through birth. But if I wasn't, right, for me to get out of New Zealand, because that's where I live most of my life, right? So for me to get out of New Zealand to get better opportunities and, you know, get more like industry experience, you need that kind of degree to apply for visas, right? And that kind of weighs a lot in. So you either have the degree helps apply for the visa, or you have to like wait for quite a long time to build up enough experience so you can get a visa. Now that's an assumption there, because I've never been in that position where I've had to gain experience to apply for a visa to go to another country. But it's a big thing to kind of, you know, consider when we think of like, you know, the majority of developers, like there is a huge chunk of developers which aren't in countries like which have access to like, you know, as much opportunities. So New Zealand's kind of job market, it's tiny, like, you know, and if you're like young and have experience, it can be a challenge. So for instance, I remember a while back when I was younger, this was 2017, late 2017, and I was starting to do all this Kubernetes stuff. And I went and looked at the job market back then. There's only two jobs for Kubernetes, like in New Zealand. Fortunately, I was in a job that did Kubernetes in New Zealand. And a couple months later, like more jobs opened up. But when I went to apply and go for those jobs, which had like looking for a Kubernetes experience, like I had the struggle when it came to people taking my application seriously and like not getting like met with a wall of like, you know, interview crap. Like I wanted, you know, when you bring up like a bank and you're like, I need to speak to a human, right? that experience right there. And I think, you know, that's another good point to bring up is during the interview process, if anyone says, you're really young, like flip it on them and tell them, you know, don't penalize me for making strategic decisions about my career from when I was like, when I was younger. Because I think, yeah, like, you know, there's that unconscious bias thing. And we often don't talk or think about it at all. But it when you go meet people in person, like, you know, they're like, oh, are you an, like, I remember this, like, my first KubeCon, like, people instantly thought, like, I was, like, an intern or something. I'm like, no, I've been developing a Kubernetes platform thing for, like, a year now. It says it on my badge. It says software engineer. Please treat me seriously. I know it looked like a literal, like, meme, but, like, yeah, pretty much. So that's another struggle. So now I kind of want to go on to the next question here is, so what led you to finding kind of the career you're in? Because I kind of went into earlier, like I turned up some dude's garage, but I want to know, Matt, how you got into like, you know, CDNJS and all that. And yeah.
Sure. I get asked this like quite often and I've yet to come up with a good answer to it because my memory is so bad. I think the rough story is whilst I was at school, because we get taught computer science at school as part of the UK curriculum, I did some web dev, I guess, as part of that, and I kind of enjoyed it and started building websites in my own time. And then through that, found CDNJS as an end user. Like I wanted to go and use, I think, Bootstrap or jQuery, and CDNJS is the recommended provider for those. So started using it. And I guess a couple of years later, you know, getting to the end of school, looking at jobs, and I go, I really enjoy kind of working with communities. I enjoy open source. What can I go do? And I realized, like, you know, CDNJS is an open source project that didn't really have many active maintainers, has zero community around it. And I went, I'll go and help out there. It's not a job, but it's something I can go and do, help out, get some experience. And I started doing that. And I then got onboarded as an official maintainer for it through the founders at the time. Chilled out there for a long time. Eventually Cloudflare took over it and I started getting paid through that. And then that led me to be hired at DO, because DO saw my experience and reached out to me and asked if I wanted to join them. And I was 17 at the time, which is scary. And to your point about being young, it's a continual meme at work how young I am.
Yeah, I really love your point when you mentioned like you started with open source, you wanted to get some experience and stuff, and via that you got your opportunities. Is that like, I'm putting it, exactly.
Yeah, so I very much encourage that. You know, open source is the best way to get into tech.
Exactly. Like, repeat, like, I'm going to put it like in the initial highlight of the video, but I agree with your point, Matt. Same thing happened with me. I started with open source because I wanted to get like experience and stuff, and that sort of like then led for me to get the opportunity. So even like the work I'm doing right now on with like SIBO and stuff, as a developer advocate, open source, and like there's one more thing that we can talk about, which is learning in public. That really helped me quite a lot in like getting the recognition, people reaching out. So when I was like 10 in my sophomore year, I used to like job hunt and stuff. And after that, like beginning my junior year, I then used to get like reached out. And even right now I get like DMs and inbox, like, hey, are you interested in this role? I found you on LinkedIn or Twitter or something like that. But yeah, I think Allison, you also talked about this previously. I saw your tweet about learning in public and how it's important to, like, if you worked hard, if you achieved something, do share about it, like on socials. You have earned the right for doing that. And in the end, only two things will happen. Like, you will get recognized and it will motivate others. It's going to raise awareness. For example, we do like, we talk about like contributing to Kubernetes, for example. Anything that I do, I share it online. And then people reach out like, hey, Kunal, thanks for sharing about that opportunity. I applied, I got in, or whatever. So I think like for me, learning in public and open source, I owe everything to open source, I think. That's sort of like how I started and how I like got to where I am like in my roles like right now.
I like to kind of touch on, I remember seeing a tweet a couple days, and I don't know, I had my Twitter settings, so like it wasn't showing the latest, but it was showing like home, so it was like recommending me tweets, and there was one that was like, startups are like a time machine for your career, and I'm like, no, well, yeah, but also open source is a time machine for your career, because you can kind of, you know, get a lot of progress and like, you know, work alongside people who are well established while you're still studying, while you're still kind of, you know, young. And that kind of, you know, collaboration, you know, really speeds up the kind of trajectory of where your career kind of takes you. So, yeah,
and with startups, is like I personally now my mindset has totally like changed towards startups, because I prefer now working at startups rather than a big tech company, because the team is small, you get more control, you get more opportunities and stuff. So right now, let's, for example, at SIBO, people are so friendly and supportive, and I can literally work on like anything I want. Even right now, let's say I'm doing developer advocacy, if tomorrow I want to do SRE stuff, they would be like happy. My experience working with like big tech companies, like it's great, but I don't really see what the hype is about, to be quite frank. I'm not saying like it's not good, but I just don't really understand what the hype is about.
Okay, because... so I can kind of talk to that point there with startups, because after like my 5 years, I just realized when I looked through my LinkedIn and I you know, did the math and I like added all my years in like dev roles, they were all at startups. So it's kind of about 5 years of startup experience. And I think what happens is like, you know, and what I'm going through right now is I'm kind of thinking, do I really want to go to a startup as my next company? I've had a lot of startups reach out to me and like, you know, they're doing exciting, there's startups out there that I've never heard of doing exciting and innovative tech. And, but what happens at startups is it can be very like, you know, unstructured and like, it can give you a lot of freedom, but at the same time, there is that whole kind of side of it, which is, you know, there are a lot of fires, you're trying to go to market, you're trying to, you know, build something and, you know, you're running on VC money. So like, you might not be making like enough revenue to cover expenditure. And so like, there is a lot of, it can be quite chaotic. Whereas with like a kind of structured big company, you can get, and that's what I've been looking in my job search, is like, because they've been around for a while, they know how to deal with scale and making kind of sure things work smoothly. And another kind of thing that came up in my mind is when you go from a big company to a startup, a buddy of mine like told me the big thing that's really valuable about like going to big company is, and then going back to startup, is when you're in a startup and you're doing a deal with big company, you can understand the process of why it takes long for deals to come through. That's kind of a vibe. But I'm going to pass it over to Matt because I want to know a little bit more, like, you know, how's like, you know, kind of, you know, your, because DigitalOcean's kind of like really well like established and you're doing the CDNJS kind of stuff, which is really interesting to me because you've got like on one hand, you're like a paid maintainer for like a project, like doing contracting kind of stuff. On the other hand, you're at like DigitalOcean and stuff. And that's a really kind of interesting because it's not like one bucket or the other, it feels like, from my perspective.
Yeah, no, to the point of like doing both, I very intentionally keep that. So when I'm doing stuff at DO, if I end up burning out on a project or something, I can just completely switch my mind to CDNJS instead and go and do some open source for a bit. So I really enjoy having the ability to just switch between multiple projects like that. With the whole startup thing, I feel like it's a really fine balance. I personally don't like working at a very small startup that's kind of right on the start of being a startup. I think there's almost too many things to juggle and too many fires to put out at that point. But equally, I don't want to be at the big tech company because you don't have freedom. You can't go and work on what you want to work on. So I really feel like there's kind of that. It's a really fine balance. I think when I joined at DO, we were towards kind of the startup end of the spectrum there. I was working on a lot of stuff. I started as a community manager. So my day-to-day job when I started was answering questions on our site. And I just naturally shifted into becoming a developer on the site. And no one stopped me. I had that freedom. I could go and do that. And now I look after the entire platform. It's my job. But I think kind of the company's grown. Obviously, we went public recently. I think kind of in some aspects, we're getting to the point now where I'd call it a big tech company. I know I can't go and jump around anymore. Like, my job is a job. But I think it's enjoyable. It's small enough still that I know what's happening and everything I'm doing has kind of clear, direct impact. I think if you end up really big tech company, you can end up working on stuff that you don't see the end result of almost.
Yeah, I love that point. I mean, I think like Allison and you mentioned, it depends on like, you know, I believe companies to companies. It's like, I think small to medium sized startups. And it also depends like, okay, at which stage is the startup right now? What they're doing? Does it align with your values and what you're interested in working on and things like that? Yeah, thanks a lot for sharing all the nice points. Cool. But I want to like ask Allison, like to you and Matt, to you as well, like what were the challenges that you faced like when you were starting out initially, like say right from college? Or I see Matt, you started out at a pretty young age, and how you overcome those challenges?
Oh, Allison, do you want to go first on this one whilst I think?
Oh, I'm jimmying up the challenges. I think for like challenges career-wise or university-wise, because the main challenge for me, like that whole kind of arc in the lore of like studying, working and doing all this like stuff. Like I even like, you know, not just open source, work study open source, but I was also very involved in like, you know, university groups. I was part of the University of Waikato's, computer science student society. And what I kind of, when I look back and I reflect on that time, it's the biggest challenge is like, you know, balancing it all, like, and having to say no to things. And like, I said no to a lot of social things when I was like younger. I remember being one of those people who was like very career orientated, and I was like, no, I can't come to town and get like get incredibly drunk. No, I can't go to this party. No, I can't go to this thing. And I remember having to say no to a lot of these kind of things that I thought were a bit like, you know, they weren't going to push me forward in my career. And when I look back on that time, I wish I kind of like, you know, said yes to some of those things because it's kind of like I'm now like, what, I'm 23 now. And I started this all when I was like, what, 17? Like I dropped out of high school. I didn't do my last year of high school. And I look back and I'm like, you know, we made some pretty big sacrifices, but yeah, spending more time like with family and friends and all those kind of things, like make sure you kind of put time for that because, you know, I think especially after the pandemic, you sometimes don't know when you're going to see people next. Like, and that kind of really hit me after KubeCon San Diego and like the pandemic happened and like I hadn't been and seen anyone from my community in like 2 years. So yeah, other challenges involve like, you know, the usual kind of, you know, organizing myself. But yeah, I want to pass it over to Matt.
Sure. I think the big challenge for me in the last couple of years has just been that whole balancing uni with work. And I think I've kind of taken it to an extreme and it's worked really well for me with COVID because my uni is remote. I don't have to go to campus. I don't have to engage in any of the social stuff if I don't want to. I just have, you know, 2 hours of lecture in the morning each day and then that's it and I can go and work. So I think I'm very lucky in that regard. Had I been actually commuting to uni, it's a 2 hour drive almost each day, which I was doing the first term, and trying to do work with that was impossible.
How did you balance that?
I didn't, was the straight answer. In the first term, I did very little work, and mostly did uni. So I don't know, I'm almost, in a weird way, I'm very glad COVID happened. It timed itself so perfectly with me being at uni. Not that COVID's a good thing, just to be clear.
Yeah, it did have like some, like people got a lot more time to self-study and the academic workload was reduced, I believe, at least for people who study computer science. I'm not sure about other branches. But yeah, for me, study and work, like by college, the main priority like is obviously exams and getting a decent GPA. I don't want to fail, obviously. So the thing that I have followed is that I am not just going to study for just to pass the exam, right? And I don't wait for I don't wait to learn a particular subject when it's in my curriculum. So it's not like, okay, database management is in my, I can't even remember in which sem it was. Let's assume it was in 6th sem, right? So it's not like it's in 6th sem, then I'll study it in 6th sem. No, I'll study it like maybe in 3rd sem or 2nd sem, whenever I have the time. And then when the actual exam comes, I would be able to score decent because I actually have interest in that subject and I actually like studied it just because I'm interested. But Allison, to your point, like there are some subjects that are not really interesting. For example, metallurgy. I was studying metallurgy in my first semester for some reason and my degree is a computer science degree. Yeah. So in India, what happens is that the first year of your engineering degree is common to all the branches, be that computer science, electrical, biotech, or anyone. The first year curriculum is common to everyone. So for my first year's computer science degree, I did not study computer science at all.
They take computer science quite literally as the science of computers.
I think that's similar to like American degree, right? Where they do like general year, then so why my degrees, what's a 3-year degree, but it took kind of 5 years to complete it. I just realized it's a 3-year degree and we don't do a general year. It's just straight into it. And another thing that just kind of popped up in my head before with challenges that you face now, that kind of leads really kind of nicely into staying organized and how kind of, you know, the tools you use to keep on top of it all. Because I mean, as you know, as you try to balance all these things at the same time, you kind of really need to make sure you have a clear page that tells you everything you know is going to be due, how much you need to score on those to at least pass. Don't aim to at least pass them, like aim to go like beyond, because what I found is early on in my degree, like, you know, when I aimed to just pass, I would fail. Whereas if I worked a little bit harder and aimed to do really well, I would at least pass or like get a little bit better. So like having a spreadsheet or using Notion.so, they have really good templates for students to track their grades, their assignments, you know, put a schedule in. And so that kind of helped, you know, keeping your eye on the target. And then as well as having your eye on the target, knowing kind of, you know, what the content is that you're going to be assessed on, like knowing every assignment that's going to come up and trying to prepare beforehand rather than like doing it on the night of. I am probably guilty for doing 80% of my assignments from my university degree the night of. Don't do this. Don't be me. You'll be stuck in university for way too long if you do a me, because I mean, if you go to my channel, Alison Dowdney, like if you just search me on YouTube, you'll see
a link
in the description. Yo, we can do that. Yeah. You might see that I did a past stream about like where I just kind of showed everyone my grades. I haven't watched it myself. It might be a bit stuttery, but I might re-record that video. But you can see in that video how much of a bit of a train wreck some of my degree was. So like I've had to drop out of like entire semesters for medical reasons. I've failed papers multiple times. And one of the key kind of themes there is, you know, not having the eye on the target and just being like, she'll be right. New Zealand kind of colloquial slang for, you know, just kind of eh. So, yeah, I want to know, Matt, how you've kind of managed to stay organized, especially, like, you know, because you've done this all, like, remote, like, you can kind of stick in the technology, because with uni in person, I was, like, using paper books and all these things, yeah.
This video is sponsored by Datree, a tool that you can use to prevent Kubernetes misconfigurations from reaching production. Using Datree, you can catch misconfigurations in the development phase and set or create policies to receive failure alerts. It's useful for different stages of deployment and helps you measure resource usage by applying mandatory labels to workloads. 10,000 plus engineers are already using Datree. Check out the links in the description below to get started today.
I don't know, really. I feel like in terms of like generally staying organized, Google Calendar and my notebook that sits next to me every hour of the day. Those two things combined keep me pretty on track. And then for university assignments, as soon as one gets assigned to me, I categorize it and I put it on GitHub. I have a private repo where I store all my uni work. So it instantly gets uploaded there. So I have the assignment there. And at the same time, I always create a markdown file for where I'm going to write my assignment. I do all my assignments in markdown. My lecturers hate me, but it's nice. I open that file and I'll leave that file open in a tab until I do that assignment. So it's always there staring at me, and right at the top of the markdown file will be when it's due and a link to the actual kind of assignment information.
I am trying to like reduce the number of tools that I'm using because it gets too much. So I'm only focusing on like calendar, obviously, and a to-do list. I use one called Todoist. It's pretty nice. It has a lot of amazing features, and that is it. Yeah, to-do list and calendar. But I also use bookmarks folders. For example, for CO, I have a bookmark on my browser. For CNCF, I have another bookmark. For my community and YouTube, I have different bookmarks. But the main tools that I use are just like calendar. I know there are some amazing tools out there, but I am really trying to limit my screen time as much as possible. So I'm not trying out new tools for that reason. I know Notion is great and stuff like that. There's so many other amazing tools to manage your day and all these other things. I am trying to manage my day without any electronic devices now.
I kind of feel that, and I do it for a slightly different reason. I know in my brain, I'm just like, if say Google Calendar stopped working one day, I'm just using a calendar.
Anything can happen after the you know, the recent 5-hour shutdown on Facebook. Anything can go down.
Yeah, so, and then like a to-do list, no matter what it is, whether it's digital or in a notebook, it's just a list. I can do it elsewhere if I need to. I don't want to become reliant on proprietary stuff like that for organizing my life.
So one thing for me, I have this kind of big thing where if it's not in my calendar, it doesn't exist. Like, I Correct. Don't know it's happening. I'm going to forget Same. About it. Like, if you say in like a message or like a random Slack, let's meet at this time and there's no invite, like it goes to the void. And if Google Calendar suddenly disappeared off the face of the earth, I'd have no meetings. It would be crazy.
Actually,
wonderful.
Yeah, open source actually would stop out. Working.
Actually, like I planned a meetup with my friends, just like to, you know, went out and actually sent them a calendar invite for that as well. They're like, dude, what are you doing? Can't you just come? I'm like, no, I don't want to risk it, you know. And whenever someone asks for a session, hey, can you deliver a session over here? I'm like, sure. Please send me a calendar invite. They don't. Few times. And then I don't show up. And then they're like, hey, Kunal, you didn't show up. Like, I specifically asked you for an invite on the email and you didn't send me. So, you know.
And I want to loop back onto that point with, I remember seeing this about like all these different tools and stuff. Like, so I remember a buddy of like, I think Mark Wilcox made this tweet a while back where it's like, or he retweeted it, or somebody I know retweeted this thing about all these like note-taking softwares being like, you know, horoscopes, like, you know, if you're like a Pisces, you're going to use like, you know, I don't know, Evernote, or Sagittarius, you do Notion. I think, yeah, one thing is picking a tool and sticking with it. So I have kind of come a couple weeks ago, like days? What is time? I made a tweet saying I'm on my like fourth or fifth strategy for like staying organized this year. And we're still managing, we're still trying to get on top of it, not going to lie. And one thing I'm kind of trying to settle on now with is I use Notion to store every single note. I was using a mix of OneNote and Notion before, but now I'm kind of trying to stick to a very simple strategy of, you know, use this one tool to put all your stuff in. And if you have something else like an iPad and you want to use a tool for that, yeah, you can say, I only use OneNote for doing sketch notes on my iPad, but I always try to import them or link them to pages in Notion where it's like, you know, trackable. Right. So I've been through the notebook stage. You know, when you buy all these pretty notebooks, write a couple pages, forget about them, then feel guilty about not writing in those notebooks for ages. So don't buy things to enable you too much to do a thing is another kind of big thing. Like, it's very easy to be like, I'm gonna buy the most expensive MacBook so I can code. And I'm like, no, you don't need to do that. Just grab your like Samsung phone, plug it into like a USB-C monitor, get a wireless like Bluetooth keyboard, and just use Gitpod or like a web-based IDE. Try to make do.
A Samsung phone.
I think most of like the Android phones kind of support some sort of desktoping. Just find even a tablet, like a cheap tablet and a web ID. Like, you don't need, like, try to make do with the tools that you have. And then once you've found, like, yourself using those tools for ages, then upgrade. Because what happens is, like, it's same with hobbies for me. I bought all this cool cake decorating stuff a while back in New Zealand. And, I didn't really do much cake decorating.
Better late than never. Well, I have a question for you all. Like, I started with DevOps like when I was in my freshman year. I'm so glad I did because of the opportunities and stuff and where I work right now. It has been great. Like, as a student, I never felt that I should not do DevOps and stuff. You are also working in DevOps, and Matt, you as well. I see people like often like on social media and stuff who don't really have a background in DevOps. They give this advice like, hey, students, don't get into DevOps because it's not for students. And then I see other people, like there's a CNCF mentorship program, right? The LFX mentorship program. This year itself, like I think 16 Google Summer of Code mentees graduated. Nikita, Nabarun, they also were a part of this thing when they were students. So many other amazing mentees graduate every year. And I personally feel like all the facts are, you know, available here in the community. It's great to get involved in DevOps if you are interested in that as a student. Like, you have tons of opportunities and the job market is also pretty good. Like you, even in the coming future, Cates is not that old, right? So what are your thoughts on this? Like, I personally feel like, I mean, according to my experience, it was one of the best decisions of my life. But what do you think?
So I'm going to steer it to like just general, like going back on that kind of one thing, people giving out thought leadership on Twitter. The thing is Twitter, it's like an airport. You can announce when you're leaving. You can announce when you're arriving. You can, people will just shout random stuff into the void, and the void will sometimes speak back and they'll be like, yeah, or then they'll be like, nah. And the thing with like a platform like that with so many opinions, take it with a grain of salt. Like, look at what you want to do. Like, don't think, oh, I have to go through all these steps and learn kind of all these things. Think about like what you enjoy doing and like the problems and things you want to build. So like, you're like, I want to build my own personal website. Like, figure out how to do that. Like, you don't have to learn that all the context first. You just have to try some things. And yeah.
Yeah, I'm with that. I know. My opinion has always been for any of this is just go and try and do it. There is nothing that could possibly go wrong from just trying something. And we're in the modern world. The internet has guidance on almost anything. Anything you want to do, someone's done it before at this point. So go out there, try it. You'll get experience from it, and it will only just grow from there.
Yeah, totally agree.
I want to also kind of jump onto like a little bit of a tangent here, like with trying things. And like another thing that comes along the scope of trying things is applying for scholarships to do things. So one kind of common thing, like I kind of wanted to like use your platform here, Kunal, to share this one kind of real key message is you see those scholarships like for KubeCon and all that. And please don't feel discouraged from applying for those. Like, please don't think that you're in a position that you're not ready yet or you're not prepared enough. Because I think what a lot of people forget about the programs like that is organizations like the CNCF are investing in the next generation of open source, right? Like, we've got this kind of big overarching problem or thing that we need to think about, which is, who's going to look after Kubernetes when kind of when the people above us retire, when I retire? Like, I don't want to be maintaining this stuff for the rest of my life. I want to be able to go retire on a beach and play Rocket League.
High aspirations.
On the beach, Rocket League?
In New Zealand, you can get really good internet, like pretty much anywhere, fiber. Nice. So like that is the dream, you know? Good internet connection and the beach. So I can walk away from Twitter and go like be in nature, but then I can walk back into the house and be like a complete, like, you know, closet kind of person. So apply for those scholarships because people want to invest in you because they see potential. Like that is one big thing I just want to share. But
to your point though, like, there is no harm in trying and asking, right?
Yeah.
Like, the worst that could possibly happen with something like that is they say no and you try again next year.
And you keep trying and you keep trying, and people will kind of see that you're like, you're still invested in trying to get into and trying to, like, you know, get involved, and people will kind of like keep tabs on you, and they'll be like,
yeah. One thing I'd like to add on to that is just like, when you don't get into a program or whatever, like, try to see how you can contribute irrespectively. For example, I got rejected for the Shadows program, but then I still like started attending the meetings and contributed to the marketing team and things like that. And then I got selected next time. So I utilized that particular gap to like contribute irrespective of whether I get selected or not. So talking about LFX mentorship programs or anything like that, I contribute to open source irrespectively. And then you get selected, that's fine. If you don't, keep contributing, then apply next year. Your application will be much stronger.
And when kind of, you know, because all these processes, shadowing, scholarships and all that, like, you get a rejection, someone had to look over that stuff, and, you know, someone will remember your name like next time it pops up, and you can kind of be like, yeah, oh, I remember applying for this, but, you know, it's okay. I've been doing these things and, like, you know, I've been watching kind of and joining in from afar. Like, you can use like every kind of, you know, negative thing, try to turn it into like a positive. See the good in the world, because you made an effort, and, like, you know, with more attempts, you know, you'll eventually land success and you'll gain more experience. You'll learn more about yourself and, you know, the problems you're trying to solve.
Most definitely. And one more point of discussion I want to really bring up, since we're talking about how to balance all these things at once, is how do you prevent, like, burnout? Because I, to be quite frank, I was getting burnout. Like, last month, I realized that. Then I sort of, like, just worked on it. But I'd love to hear your thoughts on it. Like, how do you recognize that you're getting burned out, and how do you prevent it?
I guess I will say I'm very much on the burnout train currently. And I'm kind of riding it until the end of the year, just because so much stuff going on. I'm accepting it. I don't know. For me, I recognize it simply by my brain just kind of not wanting to do stuff. I tweeted about this last night. My brain no longer wants to work on anything for more than a day straight before it decides it wants to do something else. And I notice it as that. As I mentioned this earlier, you know, I generally try to deal with it by having two completely separate things I'm working on. So I have DO and CDNJS, and I switch between them when my brain goes, I'm done with one of them. And that lets me balance it. And then, you know, ultimately taking a break. Like, I'm incredibly burnt out currently because I've been looking after Hacktoberfest for a month and a bit. And once that ends and wraps up in December, I am going to go and take some time off. And it'll be my first proper time off in a long time. And I finish uni as well, so I can actually just switch off completely.
Yeah, the only real remedy to burnout that I found, and I will say, actually, let me grab this right here. I forgot to prepare this before. We've got right here, burnout, on my conference badge when I was attending KubeCon. Because, I have been, like, you know, a bit on the burnout train as well. And I think the one thing as well, because I'm chatting to a lot of companies, I'm doing a lot of, like, interviewing things, is, you know, knowing when to reduce the scope, right? You kind of have to be, and knowing when to kind of get others involved in doing things, because as someone who's kind of like a bit of a leader in open source, I am a leader in open source, a big thing is being able to say, yes, I put my hand up, but I want to be able to bring up other people to be able to do these things, to be able to volunteer and help out, so I can take the load off myself, and then they get these great opportunities, and then, you know, they eventually can move into kind of roles in leadership and kind of take ownership. Because as I said earlier, you know, I can't work on Kubernetes forever. I want to retire on a beach and play Rocket League sometime in 20, 30 years.
Yeah, I agree to the point. And one more point I want to mention is managing priorities and how important it is to say no sometimes, mm-hmm. right? Because sometimes you already have a lot on your plate and you really want to help out someone, but you just can't, right? So it's important to manage priorities. There's this thing called the Eisenhower metrics, or something that lies, so there's the important, not important, urgent, not urgent. Something that lies in the quadrant of not urgent and not important, I just don't do it. I'm not gonna mm-hmm. do it, right? So use that sometimes for, like, time management. But for one more thing that I do, like, recently, is I get a lot of emails. So I just, whenever I wake up, I delete all the emails that I don't, let's say, bother to read, for example, because I get quite a lot. So I think it's important to, like, manage priorities is one thing I would recommend. But yeah, even after doing all these things, I was feeling a little burnout. And just like, you know, you, Matt, it's going to go on till December. But I think it should be fine, like, after December, hopefully. But I think it's better now than before. But one thing, like, that's the only thing I'd like to point out, is managing priorities is also important. Yeah.
Yeah. So on the email point, I have the same issue. Like, my inbox is continually overflowing. And I just, anything that actually needs me, my action, I pin until I do it. And that's just how I live my life. My pins are the most important thing to me.
Yeah, I just leave them as unread so that they are at the top of my screen inbox, and I filter them across in unread. And then I just, whenever I want to take an action item, I read and reply or whatever. Cool. Well, thanks a lot for joining, Allison and Matt. This was great. Another amazing episode for our podcast. And make sure you check out Allison's YouTube channel and all the other amazing things the folks do in the description below. Go subscribe and check out their socials, Twitter. I'll leave all the things in the description. And we'll see you in the next one. Bye.
See you later.